Hey folks, good evening. Thanks for joining us tonight. My name is Dave Rempis. I'm a saxophonist here in Chicago, as many of you probably know. I have a record label called Aerophonic Records, which is where I put all of my music out. I work with the Elastic Arts Foundation here in Chicago, and also the Hyde Park Jazz Festival, which is currently working on a bunch of different outdoor pop-up events over the summer. So if you're around Chicago, check out that website if you want to go see perhaps a live concert coming up. Tonight's concert is the ninth in a series of Wednesday night live streams that I've been doing. I apologize to everybody that last week got canceled. The church where I broadcast from had a classical guitar recording that they let me know about 2 hours before the broadcast last week. So unfortunately we got pushed aside for some classical guitar player, but that's how it goes. They've got me on the calendar now, so hopefully that won't happen again. As many of you know, I've been releasing a new digital release every week on Aerophonic Records to coincide with these live streams. 2 weeks ago, it was a record called Coast to Coast, which was a solo record. Last week, which was the week I missed doing streams, was a quartet record by a band called The Engines that worked for about 8 years with myself, Jed Bishop on trombones, Nate McBride on bass, and Tim Daisy on drums. That record's called Wooden Legs, and it was recorded live right here in Chicago at the Hideout in 2011. I want to open tonight with a composition by a friend of mine and a truly amazing musician in person, Joe McPhee. I was lucky to see Joe play solo about a week and a half ago on the Catalytic Sound Festival, and as always, he blew me away in many different ways. And so I wanted to play one of his compositions. This is from his record Tenor that came out in 1976. This is called Knox. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. That was Knox by the great Joe McPhee. As I mentioned, I had the chance to see Joe about a week and a half ago on the Catalytic Sound Festival, and as always, his set really moved me a lot for a number of different reasons. I first met Joe in 1997. He was playing at the first annual Empty Bottle Festival of Jazz and Improvised Music, which was organized by John Corbett and Ken Vandermark. He played in a trio with Irina Schweitzer on piano and Hamid Drake on drums. I recall watching them set up, and Irina and Hamid were up on stage, and I saw Joe walk up, and he didn't have an instrument in his hand, you know, nothing, just walked up on stage and kind of turned his back to the audience for a minute. And I was thinking, man, what's he gonna do? And he turned back around after about a minute, and he had this fanny pack on, and out of his fanny pack he'd pulled his pocket trumpet, and as soon as he turned around they hit, and it was just this really magical moment that kind of for me defined Joe McPhee as the wizard of a human being that he is. In 1998, the next year, I joined the Vandermark Five earlier that year, which was kind of my first real gig and touring experiences. And at the end of our first tour in September of 1998, after I'd been in the band about 6 months, we did a two-week tour of the States, doing a loop starting in Chicago, kind of heading down south through Indiana and Tennessee and North Carolina and back up the East Coast and then back across through New York and Ohio and Pennsylvania. And at the end of the tour, we got back to Chicago and we're doing a record release party, if I remember right, at the Empty Bottle. And Ken had asked Joe and Hamid to come and play duo that night. And I remember getting there early for sound check, and Joe, as we were all setting up, he was just kind of off in a corner by himself, and I kind of went over by him just to hear what he was doing. And he was just standing in the corner playing these really high, very quiet tenor overtones, you know, just like feather-like whispers at the very top of the horn. And as a, you know, 22-year-old kid who'd just recently gotten out of college and had always been surrounded by saxophone players who were generally all about like gymnastics and scales and showing how quickly they could play their arpeggios and warm-up patterns and, you know, basically like showing off in this kind of way, it was this very eye-opening experience to see, you know, such a seasoned musician over in the corner doing something that on the surface seemed incredibly simple in its own way, but really isn't. And that's kind of in so many ways what's summed up Joe McPhee for me, is his ability to take things that seem simple and in fact they're incredibly complex, but his ability to take all of that and boil it down to its core elements, particularly with the idea of producing an amazingly beautiful sound on his instrument. is what's been so inspiring about him for so many years to me. So that piece of his, Knox, goes out to Joe. Joe, thank you for many years of musical inspiration. I'm going to continue now. It's kind of mid-summer, as you might have heard earlier. I opened up this evening with Miles Davis off the Porgy and Bess record that he did with Gil Evans in 1958. As tiresome as it gets to hear the tune Summertime, particularly in the summer, that record is one that really does feel appropriate to like this time of year. So I wanted to open with that. And lately I find myself attracted to like jazz standards more and more. And I've just kind of been messing around with like improvising fake jazz standards on my own. So I'm gonna just try to make up some kind of jazz standard for you right now. Please enjoy it, and thanks for being here. Thank you. Jazz standard of some sort. As I mentioned, my record label is aerophonicrecords.com, which you can see right there. The new release, which came out last week, is called Wooden Legs. It's by a band called The Engines. That's, as I mentioned, available at aerophonicrecords.com under the digital releases section of the website. The Engines was a quartet that I had from about 2005 to 2013. Featuring Jeb Bishop on trombone, Nate McBride on bass, and Tim Daisy on drums. It was a band that originally focused on compositions and eventually moved on to throwing our compositions, or at least in a traditional sense, out the window. We got to the point with the band after about 4 years where we found it a bit limiting to kind of sit down and write out arrangements and play charts down. And so what we started doing was learning all our music by ear and incorporating those different compositions into our improvisations, but in a very modular, flexible kind of way. So, for example, I might bring in a melody from one of the tunes and maybe other people in the band would go along with me, or maybe they would just do their own thing, or maybe they would bring in a counter melody from another tune. Everybody was kind of free to choose how they were going to deal with the compositional elements of our improvisations, and so really anyone was free at any time to bring in different bits and pieces of material. So we might end up actually playing a tune down as an entire band, but really it was kind of left open to all the different musicians to decide. And it was a really interesting and kind of rewarding way to work. It keeps material fresh rather than playing the same thing night after night. You really have the opportunity to kind of like reconstruct things quite a bit. So that was definitely an important working group of mine for many years. It ended around 2012, 2013. Jeb Bishop, who lived in Chicago for many, many years, and we played together for easily 15 years during the time he lived here. He moved down to North Carolina in 2012, and then Nate McBride left Chicago in 2013. So at that point, it kind of didn't make sense to continue with the band as a working project. But in the time that we were together, we made three different records, two of them on Oka Disc, one of them on Not Two, the Polish label, which was a pretty special project with John Chakai, the wonderful saxophonist, reedist, spent some time in the US but was originally from Denmark. His father was Congolese, I believe, and his mother was Danish, so interesting background, and straddled both the United States and Europe in terms of his musical background. And we had the chance to work with him in 2011 to record our last record, Other Violets. Wooden Legs was recorded about a month after the recording we made with John Chakai, and that was here at the Hideout here in Chicago. And we named the record after their house cocktail at the Hideout called the Wooden Leg, which is rye, soda water, lemon, and bitters, if I remember correctly. Please check that record out. Once again, aerophonicrecords.com. It's under digital releases. There is actually another digital record that came out today, which I'll talk about in a little bit. Before that, though, I want to play a tune that we used to do with the Engines, which is on the new record. Tim Daisy was the drummer in that band, is one of my closest musical collaborators for 23 years now. Met him in Chicago quite a while ago, and it was his birthday last Wednesday, so I kind of designed this program all around the fact that it was his birthday and this release, and didn't get a chance to do it since we got preempted last week, but I want to do it tonight instead. This is a tune of Tim's called Gloxinia, which is a ballad that is on this new record, Wooden Legs. So Gloxinia by Tim Daisy.
Thank you.
That was Gloxinia by Tim Daisy. Once again, it was his birthday last week, so wish him a happy birthday if you see him. I was talking about John Chikai a little bit earlier. This band, The Engines, had the pleasure to work with him a little bit in 2011. And just wanted to talk about that a little bit since, you know, working with somebody like him is quite a special opportunity in one's lifetime. I mean, he's somebody who played with John Coltrane and Albert Eiler and Archie Shepp and Don Cherry, and certainly all of my heroes, and really managed to carve out a very unique voice in that milieu of unbelievable musicians. He still managed to figure out a way to play the saxophone in a completely unique way. I think in some ways, like Joe McPhee, he was somebody who found ways to embrace simplicity and beauty of sound rather than calisthenics or gymnastics. And that's always something that I think I struggle with. So it's great to see musicians who are able to figure that out. And the way that hookup with Chikai came about was back in 2008, Mike Reed and I did a double bill tour with our bands in Europe, my group, the Rempis Percussion Quartet, and Mike's band, Loose Assembly, with Tamika Reed, Greg Ward, Josh Abrams, and Jason Adashevitz. And it was the second tour of Europe that I'd done as a leader, but really in a way the first kind of like full-on two and a half week tour of Europe, in the Netherlands, in Belgium, in Poland, in Germany. I think that's all the countries we hit, but you know, it was 10 or 12 concerts and really amazing opportunity to tour as a young musician with my band in Europe, and to enjoy the company of another fantastic band and kind of play back and forth night to night. I'd done that once before with Ken Vandermark's band, the Vandermark Five, when we went on tour with the great Swedish and Norwegian band Atomic back in 2004, doing a three-week tour of the US. And it's always kind of special to have those opportunities to actually see another working band play night after night and see how they deal with their material, the dynamics of different rooms, like what they really do in terms of improvising. It's something you can't experience unless you actually go on tour with a band. So it's a kind of special experience. And so on this tour in 2008, we started in Belgium at a venue called Belgie in Hasselt, Belgium. And the organizers there are old friends of mine, and they always do an incredible job of putting together amazing bills. And that night they had our two bands, as well as a quartet of John Chikai's that was supposed to feature Cerrone on bass, you know, the great American bass player who had moved to Germany ages ago. Unfortunately, he got hung up in the United States for some reason and couldn't make his flight. So instead, John Chikai got Bernard Santa Cruz, who's an amazing French bass player, on the gig. I don't remember the rest of the band, but it was a really lovely concert. And at the time, Mike and I were working together on Pitchfork Music Festival. We had also started Umbrella Music in Chicago, which was a collective putting on three different concerts a week of jazz and improvised music, along with Josh Berman, Mitch Kokanig, and Ken Vandermark. And so we were organizing weekly concerts on Wednesdays at The Hideout, Thursday nights at Elastic, and Sunday nights at The Hungry Brain, and doing an annual festival each year. And during this tour in March of 2008, we were kind of looking for a headliner for the festival that year, which was coming up about 8 months off in November. And I remember standing there at soundcheck while John Chikai was playing, and I was standing next to Mike, and we both kind of had this moment where we looked at each other and thought, man, John Chikai really needs to come to Chicago. So not too long after that, we talked to him about it and managed to get him to come to Chicago that fall, which is amazing. He played in a sextet with Nicole Mitchell and Aaron Getzug and Josh Abrams and Mike Reed on drums. He played solo. He played in a duo with Hamid Drake. And so it was really this beautiful moment when a lot of different things came together. A few years later, when the Hungry Brain Sunday Night Transmission series was hitting its 10th anniversary in 2011, Mike Reed and Josh Berman, who had always organized that series, decided they wanted to do something special. And over the course of a year, they basically had one different kind of high-profile concert every single month. And Mike decided that he'd like to bring John Chikai back to Chicago for that, since the first time around had been something really special. And he asked me if this band, The Engines, might like to feature John as a guest, which, yes, of course we did. So John came in May of 2011. We rehearsed with him for a few days and made a live recording at The Hungry Brain this time, featuring John Chikai, which came out in early 2013 as Other Violets on the Polish label Not Two. That's still available, I believe. Just check out not2.com. Yeah, it was really a special experience. John was going to come back to Chicago to do the record release party with us at the Green Mill in early 2013, but unfortunately he passed away in December of 2012. I think he was about 73 or 74, and I mean, not really that old in a way. So it was kind of even more of a special opportunity to get to work with him at the very end of his life like that. Really beautiful person. And one of my favorite stories about John is when he was invited to be a special guest with the Peter Brotzmann Tentet at the Music Unlimited Festival in Wels, Austria. And Kent Kessler told me this story. He was in the band at the time, you know. The Tentet was this very loud, large 10-piece band with Peter Brotzmann and Ken Vandermark and Mats Gustafsson and all these really loud saxophone players. And so John Chikai was asked to be the special guest for one of their sets at this festival. And he walked out to begin the set with just a flute, as if that was somehow going to compete with, you know, the band. But he thought it was funny to make them all play to his level, which I really appreciate. With the reputation that that band had for being loud, it's kind of a funny tack to take, and made everybody play differently, I'm sure. So yeah, much love and respect to John Chikai. When we were playing together, he mentioned to me something that really kind of blew my mind. He said to me, man, you know that little white streak in your hair, you know, Albert had one in his beard right over here. And, you know, to get kind of, hearing real stories about Albert Eiler from somebody who actually played with him was, yeah, really a special experience. It was also Albert Eiler's birthday last week on July 13th, so I thought it might be a good opportunity to play an Albert Eiler tune. I've done this one before on one of these streams, maybe a month or two ago, I don't recall, but this is the famous Albert Eiler tune Ghosts, which came out on a Spiritual Unity record, and perhaps my favorite version is on the record of Vibrations with Don Cherry. Yeah, Ghosts by Albert Eiler.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. That was Ghosts by Albert Eiler. once again, aerophonicrecords.com is my record label. I'd love it if you're interested in purchasing anything, especially one of the two new digital releases that have come out in the last 2 weeks. Today's digital release, which was launched earlier this afternoon, is a quartet record, which we recorded 3 years ago with Silke Eberhard, a fantastic German alto saxophonist, Kent Kessler on bass, who I mentioned a little while ago, a longtime compatriot of mine. We started working together around 1997 when we were both in the Vandermark Five, and Kent and I have played in so many different bands and contexts together. It's kind of remarkable. I'm old enough now that when I joined the Vandermark Five and I was 22 years old, Kent was a little bit younger than I am now, and he's always been kind of a mentor to me and a friend and a very special person in my life, you know, just for many different reasons. We've just always had a very close friendship, and it's kind of funny to now be his age when I first met him and kind of look back in hindsight and realize, god damn, I thought he was old at the time, and he wasn't. But anyways, yeah, and Mike Reed is on drums on this record, another friend of mine who we've worked and played together in many, many different contexts. I owe a great debt of gratitude to Mike for so many reasons. He's helped me and so many people in the Chicago jazz and improvised music community out, running Constellation and The Hungry Brain for many years now. His contribution in general to the scene in Chicago has been nothing short of remarkable. So yeah, new quartet record. That record is called Exposure, and it was recorded at Elastic Arts as part of our yearly Exposure series there. The idea behind it is to bring a musician to Chicago who's not particularly well known here, to introduce them to audiences, to introduce them to musicians, and to give them the chance over a number of days to work together closely with a number of different Chicago musicians. So while Silke was here in March of 2017, she played in a trio with Jim Baker and Fred Longberg Home. She played in this quartet with myself, Kent Kessler, and Mike Reed. And she worked together in an octet doing her original music and arrangements with Katie Young on bassoon, Macy Stewart, Jason Stein, Paul G. Lorenzo, Phil Sutterberg, and Jason Remke. I think that's the whole band. And Silke was just such a fantastic choice for this. I mean, she's such a dynamic person and fantastic alto player. So it was really a pleasure to get a chance to play with her then and to hang out. So I hope you'll check this record out. It's called Exposure. I'm going to play one more tune tonight. I was talking with my friend Paul Krellen down in North Carolina just over a week ago now, and Sean Bergen came up. Sean was an amazing tenor player who was born in South Africa and lived there. I think he moved out in the 70s, basically, and moved up to Amsterdam. I think he's not particularly well known in the United States because he didn't really travel here all that often. I had a chance to see him play once at the Hideout in 2006. And Sean was an incredible bear of a guy, really warm, gruff, you know, 6'6", probably 270 pounds or something. Just this huge hulking guy who had unbelievably gorgeous tenor sound. The first time I actually met him after having seen him play was on the same double bill tour that we did with Rempis Percussion Quartet and Mike Reed's Loose Assembly in 2008. We were in Amsterdam for about 3 or 4 days during that trip. And our first night there, we were wandering around. A few people were staying at a hotel and a few people were staying at an apartment. And so those of us at the hotel were wandering across town trying to find this apartment. For those of you who know Amsterdam, it can be a very confusing city to navigate. And as somebody with generally a good sense of direction, I say that wholeheartedly. It's a very confusing place. And so we got completely lost and were wandering around the canals kind of over on the west side of downtown, not too far from like the Anne Frank House and the Westerkerk. And we're wandering around completely lost, trying to sort our way out on this map, how to get to this friend's apartment. And I think it was me and Josh Abrams and Tamika Reed and Anton Hatwich and Tim Daisy, maybe one or two other people. And as we kind of come around this corner, we hear a door open behind us and somebody yell, "Hey, Chicago! And we turn around and Sean Bergen is standing there. He just happened to be drinking at this bar and came running out after us in this hulking voice. And at that point, Sean lived pretty hard. He'd already been diagnosed with liver cancer about a year earlier. And he drank quite a lot. And his attitude after being diagnosed with liver cancer was, I don't give a shit. I'm going to keep doing what I do. And he kept doing it. He kept hitting it hard. And somehow or other, after getting a, 9 month to 1 year sentence, I believe, he lived for about another 5 or 6 years. He passed away in 2012. Really amazing tenor player. I urge you to check out his work. He did a lot with Louis Maholo Maholo. He also did a lot with a great trio called Trio San Francisco with Daniela DeGaro and Toby Delius, three tenors basically. Beautiful person, beautiful musician. After bumping into us in Amsterdam that night, he came out to one of our concerts a couple nights later, and after hearing my band play, he came up to me after the concert and he said, "Yeah, I see that all that work that Broatsman's been doing, going back and forth to Chicago all the time, has been doing some good there," which I thought was a nice comment as a big Broatsman fan, obviously. So this last piece is for Sean Bergen. This one is by Dudu Pukwana, another great saxophone player. And this was recorded with the Blue Notes, a South African band, on their Live in 1964 record. This is called Be My Dear. Thank you all for tuning in. Hey, Paul. Hey, Brian. Hey, Adam, Kip. Really appreciate you guys being here every week. It's really heartening to be able to make some music, even though it's in my little cell here. And thank you guys for tuning in always. This last one is, as I mentioned, Be My Dear by Dudu Pukwana. Thank you. you very much, everybody. Thanks for joining me tonight. On the way out, I'm going to spin another tune by Louis Maholo Maholo featuring Sean Bergen. Please enjoy. Hope to see you next week. And thanks so much for being here. Have a good one.